There we go. Sorry, everyone. I was having trouble unmuting myself. So hi, guys. Good afternoon to everyone. Thank you guys so much for joining our talk. Today, we are going to be hearing all about the scientific resources for the law. Shorthand, we'll call it SRL. And this is a program under the advisement of Dr. Eve Brank, who is here today with us. With two of her graduate students who help run the program. And so we're going to learn all about trial consulting today. I just want to start off really quick with just a poll to make sure that everyone can hear me and hear the presenters. Go ahead and just on your screen, we're going to start the poll. Can you guys fill out whether you hear me? It sounds like we got lots of people can hear me, which is wonderful. Okay, good. Cool. So I am Samantha Holdren. I'm the clinical liaison for APLS, the student committee, and I am thrilled to be here and have the opportunity to talk about this topic because I think a lot of people hear about it. They see it on TV shows and they know about what it is kind of tangentially, but a lot of us don't, including myself before I got involved, knew what it actually entails and how you can get involved in this type of field of forensic psychology. And so I'll let our presenters talk more about what SRL is in detail, but just to briefly introduce it, they're a team of researchers that operate through the University of Nebraska, the Lincoln Law Psychology Program. And so they provide research and support services to trial consultants, and they work with a lot of graduate students across the country from all different programs. And so, like I mentioned, we have Dr. Eve Brank, who is here today. She is the faculty supervisor of SRL. She received her JD and PhD from the University of Nebraska Lincoln, and she oversees and supervises SRL operations and liaisons with the university on behalf of SRL. We also have Casey Tisdale. She's a current doctoral student in the law psychology program at the University of Nebraska Lincoln, and she works as the business manager for SRL. And then we also have Josh Habe, who is here, also a graduate student in the law psychology program at UNL, and he is the former business manager for SRL, and he plans to pursue a trial consulting career upon graduation. And so today you're going to hear from each of them, and then you'll have plenty of time to ask them lots of questions. You can ask questions through there's a audience question button. Go ahead and just type those in, and I will direct the questions to the speakers. So you can type those in as they come up for you, and I'll ask them when they're appropriate. You can ask about SRL, trial consulting, the research they do, whatever you're interested in that's related, go ahead and do that. Before I let them get started, I have one more quick question for you guys. I just wanted to ask, let's see here. Where is it? I wanted to ask a poll to get an understanding of what describes you guys. What kind of people do we have here in the audience? Okay, so we got a couple of graduate students, doctoral graduate students, some undergraduates, and some PhD JD people up in here. Cool. Okay, so it's a pretty diverse crowd. It's awesome. Okay. And how do I get back? Let's see here. There we go. All right. Well, I'm going to let these guys take over and mute myself so that we don't have this crazy echo. Go ahead whenever you're ready.
Okay, I was trying to turn off my camera. Can you help me with that? Maybe? Thank you. Okay, so we're turning off our cameras because there's a weird delay, and so we're attempting that to see if that'll help things out a little bit. If you could go back to the slide before, Casey. So I wanted to talk a little bit more about who we are. I'm the faculty advisor of SRL, but I'm also a professor of psychology and the director of the Center on Children, Families, and the Law. So my primary appointment is as a faculty member in psychology, and I have a courtesy appointment at the law school. And I'll let, and we'll talk a little bit more generally about SRL, but my interest in this really came about because as Samantha mentioned, I had been a graduate student at UNL, and this was an opportunity when I was a graduate student, and I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed the availability of getting to work with trial consultants and learning more about it. Even though I didn't want to become a trial consultant, it was a really great opportunity to be able to learn about the field and then to be able to take that knowledge and use it when I taught psychology and law and now when I'm advising this SRL program. And so Josh, I'll let you talk a little bit more about your experiences with SRL.
Yeah, so I was very fortunate to come and work with Eve, and I kind of didn't know what I wanted to do, and through a series of serendipitous events, we had opportunities to work with trial consulting, and I realized, you know, I don't really think I like teaching that much, but this seems to be right up my alley. And so I got really involved with SRL, and yeah, and so I've had a lot of incredible opportunities, some of which I'm going to speak about today as examples of how we can get involved and what SRL contributes to the field. And yeah, other than that, once I get rid of this pesky dissertation, I expect to be a full-blown consultant. Yeah, so that's a little bit about me. And Casey?
Great. So my name is Casey Tisdale, and I got involved with SRL because I actually had like a weird path to SRL, kind of like Josh. I did mock trial in undergrad where we would like put on fake trials, and that's where I was like, huh, this is like really interesting, and I wonder how this would work if this was real. And then I went and interviewed at Nebraska, and I met Josh, and he told me about SRL, which I thought was really cool, and I was lucky enough to get an offer here, and I ended up here, and I kept pulling on Josh's arm, asking him when I could get involved with SRL, and then I ended up getting involved, and here I am. Yeah, and I think Josh is going to give everyone a nice overview of what trial consulting is now.
Yeah, so this is a nice canned spiel that I've had for a little while. Trial consulting, I think, is a great way to think of that as an umbrella term for those who, for a multitude of people who may work to improve the presentation of a case. So, and that can range from somewhat relatively far before trial to after the trial ends, and we'll get into that a little bit more as we go along here. And just a little sample, this really could mean someone assisting with the theme development and finding where some of the arguments or holes in the case are early on, to developing trial graphics and demonstratives, providing input on voir dire questions or strike decisions during voir dire or jury selection, maybe even the development and execution of a survey to test whether a case can be moved to another venue. So we're going to get into all that later, but that's some of the ways that, in which someone can contribute to the trial, and it's all pretty varied. And unlike other professions, trial consultants really do come from a multitude of backgrounds and trainings. Now, the focus here on screen is really social scientists, and I'd say the vast majority of individuals in the field do come from a social science background and training. But the field is quite unique in that individuals who are experts in graphic design or maybe even theater or dramatic trainings have an avenue within this field to help and contribute. Now, despite that wide range of variety from social scientists to theater actors and teachers, the field's still relatively small. Some of the estimates that I've received are closer to about somewhere between 750 to 1,000 consultants. So pretty tight-knit field. And then a little bit about just how trial consultants work. They tend to work individually. They may work individually as solo practitioners, or be arranged in small to large firms. Defining large is about 40 to 50 people, maybe. And then solo practitioners can network with other similarly situated professionals, or contract with companies that provide the services that they need. So think along the lines of audiovisual support for like a mock trial or a focus group. Recruiters who can do random digit dialing or use other online methods to recruit participants for those focus groups and mock trials, graphic design, that kind of stuff. I mentioned larger firms, and sometimes larger firms are situated in that they can do a lot of that in-house. But I mean, there's really a lot of variation here, and I think that's the key takeaway. Next slide. There it is.
Yeah, so Eve has a fun anecdote here about Dr. Phil, which hopefully will make itself a little more transparent why I'm bringing up Dr. Phil here in a couple minutes. But for all those who are familiar with the show that's on CBS right now, Bull, that is our current media perception portrayal of trial consulting in real action for us. And I actually had the opportunity to watch a few episodes. I hadn't before this. And I can say that Bull is an accurate representation if there was unlimited money and unlimited resources. Now, since we know that that is not very often the case, it's more often going to be involved with individual questions and individual parts of the trial rather than from start to finish, and that of course is going to depend entirely on the trial and the questions and of course those resources known as time and money, which are big factors that really dictate how much time and the questions you're asking and then how much the trial consultant really gives and the advice that they can add. And Bull was apparently a offshoot of Dr. Phil's career. And
yeah, I can talk about that since that probably dates back before you were born, Casey. So some of you may know that Oprah there was a case that was brought against her because she had said some things about the beef industry and beef in general. And she had to hire a trial consultant, or her attorneys hired a trial consultant. And that person was Dr. Phil. That was really where he initially got involved with Oprah. He started coming on her show after that. And of course, now, as you may know, he has his own show. But he was originally her trial consultant. And now I think he's an executive producer on Bull, this TV show. And it's tangentially based on his career, I guess. I would say that in addition to unlimited resources and money that Casey mentioned, the other difference is that Bull seems to be able to read people's minds too. And so that's a little different than what a normal trial consultant would be able to do. You may not have gotten to some of those episodes yet if you just watched a few of them, Casey. So it's a fun show, just like any TV show. It certainly is a dramatization of a career. But if you haven't had a chance to watch it, it's at least it's a mindless TV show that does present trial consulting for you. What do trial consultants actually do, though? Here's some of the examples for what trial consultants do more than what the Bull show portrays. So I'll let Josh talk about this.
Yeah, it is actually my experience that I've learned to read minds pretty well so far. So I'd object to that a little bit, but that's all right. I also heard that the recent season premiere dealt with how the trial consulting industry is dealing with courts being on hold and how there's no revenue coming in. And I thought that was a pretty interesting reference there. I still haven't had a chance to see it, and that's somewhat embarrassing. But what do trial consultants do? So these trial consultants can really assist at any and all of the three stages of a case that I've divided across here. So far before trial, a consultant can be brought in to assist with, as I mentioned earlier, change of venue or community attitudinal survey to see if people might be too prejudiced to within the venue to hold a case. I think along the lines of the Boston Marathon bomber. I believe they there was an attempt for a change of venue there. But then we also have consultants can help with theme development, or and they'd use this by using their own social science skills to and knowledge on ways to frame the presentation of arguments or how to present evidence. And then we can take that into a focus group or a mock trial being somewhat different than Casey mentioned you might have participated in high school or something like that. And that it's just really an abbreviated version of a case, maybe over a day or two, in which participants come in and are presented this abbreviated case and have the opportunity to deliberate and give feedback on what they observed. So, excuse me. So as trial consultants will work with attorneys to take what they learned from the focus group or mock trial to inform the shaping of arguments or the presentation of evidence. So I always like to reference the distinction between a copyright and a patent. For those more legally inclined, you might know this, but I've taken law classes and I have no idea what the differences between those are. Now, an experienced litigation attorney is going to, who works in this realm, is going to know the differences between those like nothing. But there's a breakdown often in the communication of that understanding to lay people. And so a consultant can come in, identify that gap, framed in a very positive way so that the attorney might be more receptive to it, and say, hey, this might be a good opportunity for us to, I don't know, insert a graphic here or something with what is a patent and what is a copyright and what applies in this situation so that individuals can use that, boil down to just the important aspects to move forward and kind of get past potentially preconceived notions or misunderstandings. So I think that that's a pretty good example of that. And you do see, in my experience, tend to see consultants come in and work on particularly complex cases and how to present that information to a jury to ensure that they understand the evidence. So additionally, in pretrial, the consultant can come in to assist with voir dire. Some of you might know that more as jury selection. Consultants can help develop questions for a pretrial questionnaire to be, or those asked during voir dire to help identify or ferret out potentially biased jurors. And sometimes consultants can even aid in strike or challenge decisions. And they're going to use some of that information from pretrial questionnaires or potentially internet research on prospective jurors or just observations through voir dire to inform some of those recommendations. So that's where Bull's mind reading ability really comes in handy, I'd assume. Then during the trial, consultants can assist day-to-day, sitting in on the trial to help develop arguments or themes, figure out ways to reframe pieces of evidence or arguments. Consultants can even be called in to assist with witness prep. And I think witness prep has some negative connotations because the expectation, or at least my understanding of it at first, was that these attorneys or consultants are basically telling witnesses what to say, but you can't do that. When I've observed this, it's generally been the consultant getting the witness who might be particularly nervous or scared to get on, to be on, I almost said on stage, to get on the stand, to prepare them for how, what that's going to look like, some of the questions they might encounter from the other side on a cross-examination. Or even, and this one's pretty interesting, is teaching the witness to, before you jump right into an answer on cross-examination, give a little pause in case you're, in case the attorney needs to object or something like that. So this is a little aside there. And then also during trial, and something we'll expound on a little bit later on, is the opportunity to run a shadow jury, which is a group of individuals that are paid to observe the trial and report on their experiences, which potentially gives insight into the aspects of the actual jury that into aspects that the actual jury might be struggling with. And I'm going to get into a little bit more of that. Those are relatively rare, but still really interesting. After trial, consultants can be called upon to conduct post-trial interviews in preparation for an appeal or just for informational purposes. And a post-trial interview is exactly what it sounds like. It's you get permission from the court to reach out to former jurors to get their experiences and maybe what was discussed in deliberations and maybe some of the driving factors behind the decision. And then, of course, we have these additional services. And I haven't really witnessed too many of these, but things like media relations, ADR, involvement in negotiations, and some of that can kind of cycle back or incorporate aspects of like a focus group or a jury trial to inform those other avenues.
Great. Thanks, Josh. So as you can see, there are a lot of different things that a trial consultant might be engaged in doing. And one of the ways I've heard it described is basically everything that's not about the legal, like the true legal argument. So letting the attorneys really focus on the legal argument, and a trial consultant can help with everything else, you know, how it's delivered and, you know, other things that are happening in the courtroom. So the major organization that that a trial consultant would be a member of is ASTC, the American Society of Trial Consultants. And if you're interested in this field, I'd recommend looking at their website. They have a really great comprehensive website. They have student memberships and a newsletter and all kinds of stuff and some resources on their website. So it's really a great resource for you as a student. There is no required credentialing at this point for trial consultants. So unlike, you know, if you're in a PhD program for clinical psychology and you need to get your internship, your PhD and go through internship, there's nothing like that for trial consulting at this point. So you don't have to be a member of ASTC and you don't have to have a certain degree, but if you are a member of an organization, it's most likely going to be ASTC. And then, Josh, do you want to talk a little bit about different types of companies a person might work for if they were a trial consultant?
Yeah, so I alluded to this a little bit early on, ASTC, well, I guess individuals can range from subcontractors who just do really specialized work, such as graphic support, something like that, to solo practitioners, who are these individuals who are really working alone or maybe in conjunction with one other person and are kind of the brains behind the operation. But those individuals, in order to pull off a lot of these projects, so those mock trials, focus groups, shadow juries, all that kind of stuff, really need the support of others. And so ASTC is an excellent place to network with those who can provide support services. But in addition to that, I think you often see individuals in like small to mid-size firms, small being maybe 4 to 5 people, maybe as few as 2. I've seen that with some frequency. There's medium size, so maybe you have 10 people, and we're just talking about trial consultants here, but expand that out and maybe it's 15 because you have the support staff there to really help you pull this off. And then some of the largest firms, I think the largest one would be, it's pretty well known, is Decision Quest, and I think they have close to as many as 100 employees, I want to say. And I'm not sure if those are trial consultants or not. But just give you an idea of the range of backgrounds and where individuals can kind of end up with this. So, yeah.
Great. So one of the things I wanted to mention about travel consulting before I get into this whole pitfall of you need experience to get a job, you need a job to get experience, is that travel consulting, much like independent contractor work, kind of goes with the economy. So when the economy is going really well and really strong, like there's tends to be a lot of work for travel consultants. There tends to be a higher need or desire for travel consultants. However, when things go south, when a national pandemic happens and people don't really have the resources to be stretched as thin, then services like travel consulting tend to become less in desire. So we can kind of talk a little bit about COVID and how we've responded to that at the end maybe. But yeah, one of the things that is a big pitfall with travel consulting and is a big pitfall with jobs maybe in general is that you need experience to get the job, and you need a job to get the experience. And this picture on the right is just like a comment or a meme that I saw online that killed me the first time I saw it, because I thought it just captured like the feeling so well of like, yes, get them experience. But yeah, so our big goal with SRL that I think Eve may allude to a little bit, but is to get people this experience, because it really is hard to get in there unless you know someone who is in on the industry or you have some kind of connection with the industry. It's pretty hard to get involved unless you want to open up your own LLC, which could be pretty hard to do these days.
Great. So this is really where one of the reasons, one of the big reasons for SRL and why we've committed a lot of our time and resources to developing this as a resource for graduate students and even undergraduates to get involved in travel consulting. Like I said, it's a really cool way to learn about the field, whether you want to go into the field or not. It's also pretty kind of just fun to learn about it. And if you want to be a faculty member, to be able to have had experience in it so that when you talk about it in your psych and law class, you have some firsthand knowledge too. And so that's really why I am the faculty advisor for SRL, because it does provide these opportunities for students. And it is housed in the law psychology program at UNL, but we've been really fortunate most years. This year has been leaner, as Casey alluded to, but we've been really fortunate to have a number of clients who come back to us and have enough jobs that we have been able to bring on researchers from outside of UNL too. And so initially it was a program that was just for UNL graduate students, law psychology graduate students, and really the demand for researchers grew beyond what we could support in just the law psychology program for students who would be interested in doing this kind of work. And so we do have a number of our researchers who are from other institutions, or maybe have our ECPs from other that have just graduated and are starting their careers. And so it's a nice wide variety and gives them opportunities across for different people. I think, Josh, you were going to talk a little bit about a student perspective for our SRL and working with an SRL.
Yeah, just from a personal experience, I think that as you're both of you spoke to, I think SRL really allowed me to learn and get the experience in the field that when I was still trying to figure out what I wanted to do, some avenues that I have of peers, or some other avenues that peers have conveyed to me is seeking out internships, but those are often take place in larger cities and are pretty hard to come by, require you to uproot whatever you're doing and go there to do that, and are few and far between. And so I think this was a pretty good opportunity for that. And then I also really found it appealing because it allowed me to take academic training from particularly social psychology and use it in more of an applied way, which I just think is an interesting avenue to see this at work outside of the lab. Much more succinct this time.
Yeah, so that's pretty much a great transition into how we do apply our travel consulting services. So SRL is a subsidiary underneath the university. With that being said, it is not like its own consulting firm. We don't take on our own individual cases where we represent like defendants or plaintiffs or anything like that. Instead, we work directly with the consulting firms that attorneys and other people are going to and are looking for business from. So basically, instead of being our own company, we're providing support to other companies, and that support ranges and the different kind of support that they may need. Like Josh said, some consulting firms are really small, so they may need help with like the more procedural aspect, like coming up with the jury questionnaires, helping with the change of venue surveys, whereas other trial consulting firms that are bigger may not need our help with procedural things like that, and may need our help with the more like researching the individual jurors and looking at their online persona to get a good snapshot of these jurors and their attitudes. So most of our research, like I was just kind of hinting to previously, is encaptured in that internet research. So it's pretty much exactly what it sounds like. You're going to be looking at people's Facebooks, their Twitter, their Instagram, any articles of them on Google, just to see if you can get a general sense of this person. Can you guess to how they're going to respond to things in the courtroom? Are they harboring certain attitudes that may have them respond to a fact or a certain aspect about the case more negatively or more positively than another person? We've also helped with venue surveys, which Josh talked about a little bit, which is when you find out like if the area where the case is being held is perhaps too prejudicial for the case to go forward, because you know that Sixth Amendment right that everyone has the right to a fair trial. And again, so we may also help with generating and reviewing those juror questionnaires. We recently had an opportunity where we actually looked over plaintiff questionnaires in a civil suit, which I thought was like a really cool opportunity to see another side and to see like the actual input that you're getting from jurors and seeing which information you want summarized, to see which information the lawyers think and the social scientists think are going to be very persuasive or very important for the upcoming trial. There's also other aspects that we do, such as summarizing fact sheets. So those very similar to the jury questionnaires, but it could be just like different, like certain trials will have like certain contexts, like for instance, whether they're about medication abuse or whether someone has, or whether this is the outcome of like an actual just using the medication. And so they may have fact sheets about their medication use. Have you used any other prescribed or non-prescribed drugs? Just to see how that kind of adds to understanding the case. And these last three things are things that Josh has a little bit more experience with. So I'm going to let him talk about those.
Yeah, so I've mentioned all three or four of these before. You might be familiar with focus groups. Those might happen a little bit earlier on. We're actually in the middle of a remote one that starts on Monday, where we just have a few jurors coming in to hear some of the case and get some of their general perceptions and perspective on what they're hearing and where they don't understand, which we then hope to use to inform a actual mock trial, which probably will also be remote. And the difference between those is where as a focus group, you're going to have probably a roundtable discussion about what's going on there. The mock trial, you're going to bring in probably closer to 20 to 30 individuals, which then you'll divide up to two or three quote-unquote juries that will then deliberate. And again, they're just seeing like a very abbreviated version of the case because you certainly can't take all the information from a three-week trial and present it in 1 or 2 days. And then we break off into these smaller juries and we'll have deliberations, which is just kind of an open discussion, have a foreperson, we get to sit there and observe it. Pretty interesting stuff. And then at the end, a moderator, which tends to be a trial consultant or maybe even a junior consultant, will come in and ask some more specific questions, some hypotheticals, some what ifs. I heard that you were talking that this seemed to be a really point of contention, like where did that come from, that kind of stuff. I'm going to just go ahead and table shadow juries because a little foreshadowing here, that is going to be something I dive a little bit deeper into. And then I gave y'all an overview of the post-trial interviews, which is basically the consultant just develops an interview schedule of very specific questions. And earlier on in SRL, we had researchers, we had a couple of these opportunities where researchers were able to call up these jurors and ask them to participate in this interview and tell us about some of their experiences. And then we're basically just taking notes and summarizing those notes and sharing them with the consultant in that way. So yeah, that's basically those four things.
And I'll just jump in here quickly with something impromptu that just occurred to me. We're talking in pretty broad generalities and not giving you specific case examples because everything we do is obviously confidential. And so we are required to keep specific cases that we've worked on completely confidential. We aren't allowed to talk about them, you know, with our friends and families and things like that. So it's similar to what it's like, you know, if you're an attorney on a case. And so if you're thinking, gosh, they're really not giving me any very specific examples with all of that, that's intentional. We can talk, we're definitely open to questions and we can answer what we can at the end of our presentation too. So I interrupted you a little bit, Josh, there, but I think we can go now on to juries.
Yeah, absolutely. So these, we selected out shadow juries as an exemplar to demonstrate just all the points at which individuals like SRL researchers can participate or provide support throughout an endeavor. So specifically referring to this shadow jury, and we only got to do this once, and with a client, a trial consulting client who really, I think, has very stringent research methods, which is very impressive. And so as a part of that, there's, of course, a recruitment process where the recruiter will just call or bring in people from the venue or a matched venue. So that's the area in which the case would take place, or an area like the place where the place where the case would take place. That was confusing. And once that's happening, like our client, for instance, was really particular that individuals might needed to match certain criteria to be selected. So for instance, those who do a lot of focus group or mock trials and are very familiar with this process, we really don't want them because they're a little more, they kind of know what they're doing. So that was something that we'd keep an eye on. So our team was able to assist with that recruitment and make sure that the trial consulting client's wants and needs were being met by the recruiter. So we were kind of that liaison between the two, because as you might imagine, the actual trial consultant is incredibly busy coming up with the script for the case, the structure of things, going through exhibits, and they're really quite busy. So we provide that support there and alleviate some of that. So as a testament to this client's concern about the quality of the recruits that we have, we then held focus groups in which some of the participants that we were particularly interested in, we brought them in, we had like a roundtable discussion, got to know them a little bit better, and that way we could find those who we felt would be well-equipped to contribute and be able to assist and speak to and really sit through what can be a pretty trying task of you're in court every day that the jury's in there. So for this case, a 3-week trial, taking notes, listening, and then at the end of the day, holding an interview. So that can oftentimes be 8, 10, 12 hour day potentially. So we were looking for those who we thought would be a good candidates for that. And then from that group that we had kind of whittled down, we then had a pretty good idea of who we'd like to be there, but we did our best to match the actual panel. So the actual jury was seated and we saw the composition of that number of males, females. We had some information on them, so their trainings, their backgrounds, that kind of stuff. And we were able to do our best within a very short period of time to try and replicate some of what we anticipated would be similar attitudes, experiences to those who are actually on the panel from the individuals we had in the focus group. So that was pretty stressful, but was really interesting. And then we got into the fun stuff, which is that day in, day out of in-court monitoring. Long story short, basically anytime the actual jurors were in the courtroom, our shadow jurors were in there too. If there was a recess or a break, if there was the jurors were there or weren't there, if the attorneys and the judge had a sidebar conversation or conversation outside of the purview of the jury, our jurors weren't there either. So what we're really trying to do is just expose those shadow jurors to exactly what the jury's seeing so that they're having as much of a similar experience as those jurors are. Because what we're doing, as I mentioned, is having a debrief interview every day to try and assess what the shadow jurors didn't understand, what they found confusing, what they liked, what they thought was compelling. And we're taking that information. These were all SRL researchers that were doing these daily interviews. They put together a quick report with some of this information. The trial consultant would take all those reports, compile them together, and share them with the trial team, who then can take some of that feedback and adjust as necessary. So if there's something that the trial team thinks that they're really explaining well, but a couple of our shadow jurors just didn't get, they should be looking for an opportunity moving forward to revisit that and maybe explain it in a different way or in a better way, just as an example. Then just like as the case came to a close, then the real jury went into deliberations. We took our shadow jury, put them in a room, and let them deliberate as well. Uninterrupted, they had the same jury instructions, the same jury questions, and decided the same thing. So then they went from there, had their deliberations, and we, once they came to their verdict and their decision about damages, we then took that information and generated a report to the trial team saying, hey, this is where they came out on. You know, they originally split maybe 4-2, or 3-3, but this point seemed to really move people over. They ended up voting this way unanimously, and this decided on X number for damages. And just as an aside, and obviously we have a very small sample size, it's very rewarding because our shadow jurors not only predicted the verdict correctly, but the damages were actually very similar as well. I think our jurors decided differently on some type of non-economic damages, but that was a pretty fascinating experience to be a part of.
Yeah, so now SRL pretty much, especially with COVID, SRL is doing a lot of internet research opportunities because those tend to be a lot of our remote opportunities. But we do have some in-person opportunities, just like Josh was talking about with the mock trials and the shadow juries. But we're always looking for new opportunities in case like any consultants are interested, or in case anyone is interested in working with us and getting some experience. And one of those new opportunities, like I cannot tip my hat to Eve enough for setting up all she does for SRL, but was creating this contribution to the ASTC newsletter in research reviews. So basically what we do is we take a new research article, and we summarize it, and then we try to come up or we summarize it for how it could be used for trials or however the actual implications of the articles are. And then we summarize it and send it to the newsletter so that hopefully we can try to bridge that gap between research and practice and see some of this research in real life or see if people can implement it with care. And then we've also had some pro bono services. We did this a little bit before I came on, so Josh and Eve may be able to speak about this a little bit more. But I know that we originally offered our services at no cost, that's what pro bono means, and then we were able to pay out our workers some sum to reward them for all their hard work that they did on the case.
So that brings up the basically the researchers who work for SRL, we try very hard to make sure that they are compensated for their time. So we have negotiated rates with each of the consultants we work with to make sure that our graduate students and undergraduates and, you know, recent graduates, SRL workers are compensated for their time. And one of our, some of that money goes to supporting SRL generally. Some of it goes back to the individual worker, so their time is compensated. But then we've also been really trying to work towards being able to provide pro bono services in criminal cases where there's often not a lot of money to pay out. So we were fortunate to be able to work on one of those cases a couple years ago. And I think we're pretty close to the where we wanted to be in terms of time to open it up for questions. I'll put this up here and this little over in the corner, you can see our website. If you haven't already Googled that, that's where you can go to look for more information. If you're interested in working and applying to work with us, you can find information on that website about an email address to reach out to and apply to work with us.
Awesome. Thank you, guys. So I do, we have a couple audience questions here. So the first one I'm going to show to you guys. So this question, if I am not a student at UNL, can I get involved and how? How can someone who's not at UNL get involved? What is that process and what does it look like?
Okay, great. Thank you. Samantha, I think you need to mute. There. Okay. Like I said, we have been able to expand beyond just UNL students. And so the application process is a statement of interest and a CV. Casey, I can't remember if there's anything else, but I think that's it. Casey can let you know.
Yeah, that's pretty much the whole process. At least up front, you send me your statement of interest in a CV, and then I get back to you with availability. We do a meet and greet just to make sure that our interests are aligned. And then, yeah, as long as you fill out the paperwork and you're more than happy to work remote and then in person, of course, when you can, then yeah, we'd love to have you. I think we just recently expanded to include non-UNL students, like within the last couple of years.
Yeah, definitely. And we do have things we're looking for, right? So it's not just open to everyone. It's not just an open, anybody can do this. We are looking to make sure that you have a background in work that you've done, that you're responsible, a background, hopefully in some sort of social science or the law, and that working with us makes sense, that you're going to be reliable and a good partner for us, because obviously you're representing SRL, and so we want to make sure that you're representing us well.
All right. The next question, what kinds of psychology methods do you use in your trial consulting? And let me mute myself for the answer.
Thank you. We're getting really good at this, muting, unmuting. Samantha, thanks. I'll start, and then if Josh or Casey want to add anything into that. So one of the things that we alluded to earlier on is that we work completely with trial consultant. So we're not hired directly by attorneys. And so it's a real mentoring opportunity to get to work with these trial consultants in the field. And we use what they are asking us to do mostly. So we're not coming up with our own survey methodology, or we're not coming up with our own any kinds of, you know, techniques or anything like that. We're getting mentored by them and doing what they want us to do. If you're asking just generally what kinds of, you know, research experience you might need or would be useful or what you would learn from, we certainly do surveys. That's one thing, obviously, survey methodology, the focus groups and, you know, open-ended kind of interview questions. Those are some other methods. I'm going to let Josh and Casey chime in terms of other ideas they have.
Yeah, I think you see it. I think it's more that you see the intention and the purpose behind the methodology come forward. I don't think it's always as clean. Well, it's not as clean as you're going to see or be able to control in the lab or through a survey or something like that. I mean, you're working with much smaller groups, right? The focus group that we're in the middle of right now is 12 people. That's a pretty small sample size. And when you're talking about mock trials, which are much larger by comparison, you know, that's 30 people. And so you're not really using necessarily like advanced statistical methods, but you are setting up surveys or questionnaires, let's say through a mock trial, in which you're going to get a baseline assessment of where the individual is potentially leaning after the neutral statement of facts at the beginning of a mock trial, and then after generally every presentation of a the plaintiff's presentation, you're going to have another time survey and see how that's affecting leanings and what the individual took away from that. Then after the defense, same thing, and that kind of stuff. And so you get to see in probably less of a clean way than you would in academic research per se, the individual, just what's swaying an individual's decision making. And I think that's one of the things that I've been the most interested in. And I think it also extends to theory, right? So you can you use your knowledge of theory to inform and anticipate potentially some of the decision-making that individuals might be engaging in, hindsight bias, confirmation bias. I think hindsight bias is a great one of, we know that this bad outcome happened because we're at this point in a case, but we didn't always know that this was going to happen. And I think that's something that I see that the trial team will try and reassure or explain to jurors and inoculate a little bit about. But yeah, I think it's quite varied and not as clean as the as in lab research, excuse me.
And just to kind of expound upon what Josh was saying, like, this is definitely an applied field. So there's a lot of like mixed methods that is coming into it. And just like Eve brought up, like, there's a lot of reliance on survey methodology, but in the focus groups and in the like mock trials, you're also doing a lot of interviewing and you're trying to figure out why for a lot of things. So yeah, it's good to have like qualitative and quantitative skills just for those reasons. And just because, like Josh said, like, it is, it's not as clean as a lab setting. It is a little messy. So sometimes, like, in the middle of a quantitative survey, someone's going to give you like some qualitative input and like, and say, I don't understand this. And that may be like very impactful for the case.
All right, we have another question. So let me see if I can put this on the screen. Okay. So can trial consulting be done as a career with a clinical psychology PhD? So as someone who's just applied for some of these programs, including UNL, good luck. This person is wondering if that would be possible.
And yes, is the short answer to that. There are a lot of different backgrounds people have who are in the trial consulting field. And those backgrounds often dictate, you know, kind of what your focus would be. But I certainly know of clinical psychologists who have gone this route.
Yeah, there are definitely, we have forensic psychologists that are working with SRL. We have just clinical psychologists that are working with SRL. Josh, Eve, and I are social psychologists. So it's like not required by any means, but it is like very helpful that if you have a social science background.
Yeah, I would also add and implore Eve and Casey to contribute. I think that the clinical perspective can also, or clinical training can also bring new opportunities potentially. So, and we're talking about consulting, maybe less in the trial consulting and what we've talked about today, but in terms of being an expert witness in a term, if you're going like down a psychopathology avenue or something like that. I think there's sometimes that consulting where you're hired as an expert is conflated with trial consulting. I think what we're just talking about is distinct, or we're trying to describe as distinct, but I do know individuals who have been hired as experts or something like that and working in a consulting capacity. And I don't think that that's exactly what you were getting at, but it did kind of jog my memory and think it might be important to distinguish between some of that.
Awesome. I have a question. And so you mentioned before doing pro bono work for criminal cases. What is the split of criminal versus civil cases that you guys do? And what is the difference between those two usually? What does that look like for the work that's being done?
Yeah, so Josh will be able to help me better probably with this in terms of actual numbers, but I'm pretty sure we've only done one criminal case. And so in terms of the split, in terms of what those look like differently, I mean, the legal questions are obviously different. So there would be what you're asked to do as a consultant and as an SRL researcher might look a little differently because of the research questions. But then sometimes they're not that different because, you know, if we're thinking what we're interested in is jury, you know, summarizing jury questionnaires, that could be very similar type of task that we'd be doing. Josh, am I correct? That was our only criminal case we've done?
Yeah. I mean, we haven't really gone out and solicited for that per se, but the opportunity came along and it was something that a lot of people were interested in. And I think we were very fortunate to have the opportunity to do. So yeah, we have a pretty small sample size of comparing those two within the field generally, at least within my exposure, which of course is reflective in our numbers of what we've done with SRL. The vast majority of what we've done has been civil work. And I think that would be reflected within the field at large. But you certainly do see individuals who specialize in criminal side of things, most often the subset being, you know, criminal defense. So individuals like, I forget her last name, but if anybody's seen The Staircase, Marjorie is a very well-established trial consultant who works only in criminal defense. As you might expect, that's not generally as lucrative, but it is a pretty exciting field to be in. And I think it really is only recently that SRL was in a position that we had the resources to be able to support, to provide support to criminal cases. And so I think when that came through, it was a very interesting case And I think the general consensus was that we were all interested in doing it a little bit more. But at the same time, we only work underneath the guidance of actual trial consultants. So we don't want to solicit from a criminal defendant or be able to try and offer our services to them, because we want to make sure that we are working under the guidance of somebody who is an expert in this field, so that we not only get our training as students and up and comers, but then also, and then they've provided the services that they need to get through to fulfill some of their needs. So I think I'm excited to see what the future holds. Especially when the courts start opening up a little bit more.
Yeah, so maybe this is a bit of a downer of a question, but how has COVID affected the work that you've been doing, and what have you guys been doing to adjust to the new world that we live in?
Sure. Yeah. So, well, like all of you, we have been working at home. And so that's cut down on our travel to get to go to, you know, we have had opportunities to go to on-site cases in the past. And so when the courts have shut down, that means there's no cases going forward. And so trial consultants aren't doing any cases. And so there was not anything for SRL to do either. As Casey said, one of the things it gave us time to foster this relationship with ASTC. So we now have this really cool new relationship with them, where we're writing research briefs. SRL researchers are getting the opportunity to write research briefs for the ASTC newsletter. So that's allowing still a little contact with ASTC. And, you know, things are starting to open back up. The courts are being extraordinarily creative with virtual. And so that's opening up some potential opportunities for trial consultants to also try to do their work virtually. And I know there's some work that Josh is working on related to that. And so I think we're now, you know, it's actually kind of an exciting time, because I think for everything, courts included, we have this opportunity to see, can we do things a little differently than we had. Are there ways to leverage this virtual online world in a way that actually could make things more efficient and could make things, fairer even? So I think things are going to be, it's a pretty exciting time to be thinking about the courts and cases within the courts.
Awesome. Well, I have a final question, and it looks like the rest of the audience, I don't see any other questions, but get them in if you have any. So if someone were to want to do this, and this was kind of the direction they were going for their career, what are, I guess, financial considerations? I know you said that criminal cases tend to be less lucrative, but I guess, what are people getting themselves into if they go this route? And muting.
That's a great question. And I can say I don't talk to our trial consultants about like how much money they're making or anything like that. So I can't speak to, you know, what kind of salary a person would make. I think if you got involved in SRL and you were, you know, an SRL researcher and you were able to meet consultants, that could be a conversation you might be able to have with someone after a while, after you got to know them. It's going to vary greatly, most likely, depending on what kind of consulting you go into. You know, if you're going, so there's, like Josh already talked about, all the different kind of options. So it's hard to speak to, this is the general salary that you're going to make. This isn't like going out and being an assistant professor at a big, you know, research university. It's going to be quite varied, depending on a lot of different factors. I don't think we can speak to anything on the specifics of that.
Sorry, I was just going to say, I was thinking more when you're starting up to do this, what kinds of resources do you use? What sorts of things are you going to need to get started, and connections and things like that, more so than like, what can I expect to make?
Okay. So do you mean like if you wanted to join SRL or if you wanted to be a trial consultant?
I guess either one.
Okay. So let me talk about if you wanted to join SRL, like we already talked about, you could apply for that. We would review and interview you. And from there, our expectation is that you have a good internet connection, you know, reliable computers, that you're, usually able to communicate quickly is generally what we're asking for someone in terms of investments. So not much different than what you would need if you were going to graduate school. In terms of you get out, you now have your PhD or your JD or whatever, what's it going to take to start up one of, you know, to like actually get into this field? That's going to be very dependent on what direction you take. If you want to join a firm, you know, they will have, you will join that firm similar to the way you would join other and start other jobs. If you want to hang your own shingle, that's going to take, you know, quite a bit of equity and investment to start your own business, like any starting any own your own business. Does that help, Samantha?
Yes, that was perfect. Thank you. Awesome. Do we have any other questions from the audience? I think that was the last that I had.
So can you do a poll?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. So I would be interested in knowing like why people attended this webinar. So, are you interested in the field generally? Was it just, you just want to know about careers in psych and law? Are you thinking of going into this field? I don't know. I bet you can come up with some options that will make sense, Samantha. Sorry to put you on the spot.
Not a problem. Hold on. Just
and I'll tell everybody, this was my first time using AnyMeeting. I think it was Casey and Josh's first time using AnyMeeting. So thanks for your patience as we were figuring out and changing our minds from Zoom, which is all we've been on for 10 months or 9 months.
Yes, I echo that. And thanks everyone for coming, especially, you know, everything going on in the world right now. I'm sure it takes a lot to give something your attention for an hour and a half. So I really appreciate everyone who came to hear what we have to say and for the members of hosting this. So that's great.
Okay, so I only have some, so we have interest in the field generally, and then some interest in becoming a trial consultant, academic interest.
That is perfect, Samantha. Well done. I appreciate that.
Good. Okay, so more interest in becoming a trial consultant, about split between just general interest and wanting to go into the field. We're slowly trickling in. Okay. So we've got a good split. It looks like there might be, was there another question that I just saw or no? Okay, I think that is everyone who's going to be answering. Well, unless there is a very last minute question, I think that's going to be it for today. But I just want to thank you all so much. You guys have been so informative, and this has probably been one of the more interesting topics that I have participated in. So I really appreciate you being here to talk to us today and being willing to answer all these questions.
Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity.
All right, I think we're going to end there.